Hello, and welcome back to the Dechert For Real podcast, where we discuss current issues and trends for commercial real estate finance. We aim to bring market commentary, updates you can use, and hopefully a little bit of banter along the way. I'm Jon Gaynor, a counsel based in Dechert's Philadelphia office.
I'm Ella Smith, a partner based in Dechert's Charlotte office.
And I'm Sam Gilbert, a partner based up in Dechert's Boston office.
And today we'll be joined by Dechert partner Lindsay Trapp to discuss fund formation and commercial real estate. Before that, in our 411 segment, where we talk about issues percolating in the market, you'll hear a medium deep dive into recent challenges around climate disclosure rules. But first, let's get For Real with the host to break the ice. Winter is finally over in Philadelphia, so I thought we would get For Real today by talking about our favorite springtime activities. Ella, what do you like most about spring?
Well, John, honestly, I hate so much about winter that I just love everything about spring. I feel like the whole world is waking up and coming back to life after the cold, dark winter. I love like opening my front door and not being forced to run back inside because of the Arctic chill in the air. I love going out to walk the dog without having to put on a parka and a knit hat and gloves and a scarf. I just don't like cold weather, and spring starts early here in North Carolina. So this past weekend was Easter, and we had weather in the 70s and 80s, which to me is absolutely perfect so long as you're in the sun. In the shade, it could be a little chilly.
Well, as a fellow non-cold enjoyer, I can entirely relate. What about you, Sam?
Well, as of the date of this recording, we're expecting almost a foot of snow here in the next couple of days up in the New Hampshire, Boston area. But setting that aside, my favorite springtime activity up here in New England is Patriots Day. It's a holiday we have up here in Massachusetts, and I think a few other states, Maine and maybe some others. It's the third Monday in April. There's the day off from work, and then you've got the Boston Marathon, which runs right through Kenmore Square towards the end. And the Red Sox traditionally have a home game that usually starts about 11 a.m. So you can go to the Sox game, and by the seventh or eighth inning, you know, the Marathoners are usually coming through Kenmore Square, which is right by Fenway, and you can walk right down there and see them. It's sort of the unofficial start to spring here in New England, and always a great day and fun to kick off the season.
I think it would be fun if the temperatures were above freezing.
It's usually mid-30s at first pitch, so it's not the best spectating weather for the game, but it's good for running, I guess.
Good for running. I do not like to run outside unless it's at least 62 degrees, and that's probably the first thing I like about spring in Philly is the temperature gets above 60 on occasion. My other favorite thing is the two-week period at the start of spring when all the cherry blossoms and all the other flowering trees are blooming, at least until all the petals fall down onto my car. So that's like just a very pretty time in the city.
It's beautiful, but you don't suffer from spring allergies with all the beautiful pollen in the air?
I fortunately do not. My kids and my wife do a little bit. So, you know, it comes as a mixed blessing, and the flowers are only there for about 2 weeks, so it's not that bad. I think that counts as getting For Real. That brings us to our 411s this month. On March 6, 2024, the SEC issued a final rule on disclosure of certain climate-related information under the title, The Enhancement and Standardization of Climate-Related Disclosure for Investors. We previously discussed the related proposed rules at length with Dechert partner Jason Roses in episode 2 of this podcast last June, which you can find linked in our show notes if you're interested. His predictions and insights hold up. So what is in the rule? First, filers will be required to make disclosures of financial impacts from severe weather events and other natural conditions, material climate risks and management, climate targets, and governance oversight details. The rule also requires the disclosure of material Scope 1 and Scope 2 greenhouse gas emissions for certain filers, albeit with a phased assurance requirement and softened rules compared to the initial proposal.
And John, can you just remind our listeners and me what Scope 1 and Scope 2 greenhouse gas emissions are?
So the concept of the three scopes of greenhouse gas emissions emerged from efforts to standardize greenhouse gas accounting and reporting. Scope 1 emissions are direct emissions that occur from sources that are owned or controlled by an organization. An example of this would be the greenhouse gases from the fuel you yourself burn in the boilers of your buildings. Scope 2 emissions are indirect emissions that are associated with the purchase of electricity, steam, heat, or cooling. Scope 3 emissions include all other indirect emissions that occur in the value chain of the reporting company, including both upstream and downstream emissions. Critically for folks in a commercial real estate finance, Scope 3 also includes emissions that you finance. So this includes if you make a loan on a construction of a building, or if you lend to an emissions-heavy sector, or even the energy use in the data centers that you finance.
That's right. I remember these Scope 3 emissions, which were in the proposed rule, are sort of very indirect emissions. Does the final rule still cover these Scope 3 emissions?
No. The rule eliminates the necessity of Scope 3 GHG emission disclosures, but, and this is without spoilers for Ella's part of the 411, do not get too excited. The SEC hinted that Scope 3 disclosures could be coming later as reporting around these develops over time.
I think many companies already have some level of internal tracking in place for Scope 1 and Scope 2 emissions, but accurately tracking Scope 3 emissions, which are linked to supply chains and end users, will require a lot of coordination.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And this may get easier over time as people do their Scope 1 and Scope 2 reporting. Maybe there's a way you can import members of your value chain to get that reporting into your Scope 3 reporting. Thankfully, at least for purposes of the SEC's rule, not an immediate problem.
It would seem that someone's Scope 3 emissions reporting would be someone else's Scope 1 emissions reporting. So maybe once you start reporting Scope 1, it will be easier to get that information to use on Scope 3.
I think that's right. I think that we will see this develop over time. And we haven't heard the last of Scope 3, not from the SEC and not otherwise. Compared to the proposed rule, the final rule also reduces the breadth of the financial statement disclosure requirements and extends the implementation timeline, offering registrants more time to prepare for disclosures and related assurance demands. Smaller reporting companies, emerging growth companies, and non-accelerated filers are exempt from Scope 1 and Scope 2 emission disclosure requirements, as are the issuers of asset-backed securities. The rules phase in compliance dates starting in 2026 for the fiscal year ending in 2025 for large accelerated filers, with extended dates for other filers after that. For commercial real estate lenders and issuers of asset-backed securities, the direct impact might be less severe compared to operating companies. Of course, public REITs and others who are required to file reports are directly impacted and should be ready to meet any of the new disclosure obligations as dictated by their material climate-related risks. The rule may also influence standardized climate-related risk assessments and investment practices in the asset management industry generally, including for privately held debt funds and other vehicles. If you want to read more on this rule, members of the Dechert Environmental, Social, and Governance Task Force put out an article, which you can find in the show notes. Of course, the rule is already facing challenges in court. Sam, can you take a minute to describe those?
Yeah, of course. What would a good rule be without some challenge to it, right? So as of today's recording, the rule is already facing 9 different challenges in 6 different circuit courts of appeal. Although 4 of those cases were filed in the Fifth Circuit, and those were consolidated into one challenge. So there's a number of challenges out there. In the Fifth Circuit, somebody requested a stay, and the Fifth Circuit went ahead and granted that, just a temporary administrative stay against the rule, pending the challenge. The cases were all then assigned via a lottery to the Eighth Circuit. I think a clerk actually picks, you know, a name out of a hat, and these all get assigned to the Eighth Circuit. So the stay in the Fifth Circuit, if you're following all of this, was lifted in connection with the transfer to the Eighth Circuit. Not all of the challenges, it's important, I think, to point out, were trying to eliminate the rule. The Sierra Club and some others filed suits arguing that the SEC had scaled the rules back too much. So there's some challenges on both sides here. In the Eighth Circuit, of the 17 judges, only one of them was appointed by a Democratic president. So we'll see how that plays out, and you can make your own judgment as to which way this is going to go. But there are challenges coming in from both sides here. You know, obviously, it'll take a while for all of this litigation to play out in court. On top of that, the legal landscape is not really clear right now, as the courts have been reshaping how government agencies are able to interpret their authority under relevant laws. Sometime this term, the U.S. Supreme Court is set to make a decision in a case that challenges the Chevron deference, which is the idea that courts are to defer to government agency interpretations of law when the intent of Congress is ambiguous. You know, also courts have recently been emphasizing the major questions doctrine, which is the idea that Congress does not delegate major political or economic issues to government agencies without clear authorization. So a lot going on in the background here. Quick editor's note, since this episode was recorded, we've had a couple developments. We've had an earthquake on the Northeast. We've had a total eclipse. And now the SEC has paused the rule. They've gone ahead and officially halted it, I think acknowledging the fact that all this litigation is going on and wanting to sort of back down a little bit and let the courts work through the issues. The SEC is still going to defend the rules. They're not backing down from their view that they have the authority to do this, but they are going to step back and allow the courts to focus on this. So we'll see where this goes, but another development in this issue.
And now back to your regularly scheduled program.
Separately, there are some challenges to California laws. The two California laws that are similar to the SEC rules are also subject to litigation. Lawsuits filed earlier this year, California has filed a motion to dismiss those, but we'll also get back to you and update you as those things progress. And while all this litigation casts a little bit of uncertainty into the future of the SEC's climate disclosure rule, Ella's going to talk about some reasons why filing companies may decide not to just delay preparing to comply now that this litigation is going on.
Yeah, thanks, Sam. I think it's important to note that even outside of the SEC's rule, certain jurisdictions have developed or are developing their own rules that may overlap with the SEC rules and create additional obligations. I'm really thinking of California, which has three new disclosure laws that cover some of the same ground as the SEC rules. For example, California's SB 253 law goes further than the SEC rules. The SEC regulations require that public companies disclose scope 1 and scope 2 emissions. The California law will require both public and private companies to disclose scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3 emissions, so long as they're doing business in California and have annual revenues over $1 billion. In addition to SB 253, California also has an SB 261 law that will apply to companies other than insurance companies with annual revenues over $500 million that do business in California, and it will require them to file reports disclosing their climate-related financial risk and measures they have adopted to reduce and adapt to that risk. And finally, there's a third California law called AB 1305 that establishes reporting and disclosure requirements for business entities that make climate-related claims about themselves or their products, as well as voluntary carbon offset market participants. I think one big question here is, who is doing business in California? Regulators have pointed to other existing California laws to define this as any business that is engaged in any transaction for the purpose of financial gain in California. So that could be a very broad definition and could include a lot of companies that might not consider themselves as doing business in California because they're not domiciled or headquartered there.
Golly, so that could very easily touch our real estate fund clients and public REIT clients, and maybe even other folks who never even dreamed that they'd have to comply with the SEC's rule directly.
Absolutely.
Great. Today, we welcome Lindsay Trapp to the podcast. Lindsay is a partner in Dechert's global finance team who is a dual American and Irish qualified lawyer who specializes in complex credit fund formation and insurance solutions for private fund sponsors worldwide. Lindsay's practice focuses on assisting global asset managers and sponsors in the structuring and formation of complex credit private funds and structured credit funds, as well as assisting with post-establishment compliance and distribution. That's a lot. Wow. Lindsay, welcome to the Dechert For Real podcast. We're delighted to have you.
Thanks, John. Very nice to be with all of you guys today.
So we're really looking forward to talking with you about the substance of fund formation. But first, it is our tradition to get for real with our guests. So, do you have a favorite thing about springtime?
I do. I, like Ella, live here in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I am the proud mother of two squishy-faced dogs. So, it's very exciting for me in the springtime that they get to go outside without having any clothes on, either winter coats or their cooling vests that they have to wear in the summer. High-maintenance dogs, you know.
Oh, yeah. Well, makes me wonder if there's a podcast merch opportunity. Dechert For Real branded doggy puffer vests. So I'm going to talk to Stuart, one of our producers, about that, who's in charge of our merch, to see if there's something we could do there.
And can we request that Lindsay post a picture of her adorable doggies in their little winter coats on LinkedIn so we can all enjoy it when we release this podcast episode?
Oh, absolutely. My boy dog, Doc, was actually raised in the Dublin office while I was there. He spent the first several months of his life in the office. So he's the original Dechert dog. He'd be very proud to sport that.
Our own mascot.
Thank you for getting for real with us. Now on to today's topic of fund formation. So let's address the elephant in the room here. Funds work is not strictly or not even primarily about commercial real estate. So please excuse me for being a real estate meathead, but help me out with some basics. Explain your practice area and what you do here at Dechert and how you help our clients.
Sure. So by training and at my core, I'm a private fund formation lawyer. I specialize in credit-related funds, primarily corporate credit, but definitely get involved in a lot of real estate credit as well. Fund formation is essentially coming up with products and structures that work for distribution to various types of investors. So basically bringing capital to the managers so that they can deploy. I specialize in cross-border distribution, obviously, having an Irish qualification as well. And then I have two very specific niches, which is where I spend most of my time, which is in rated funds for raising insurance capital, and then captive CLO equity funds, particularly those which are part of the EU risk retention compliance CLO programs.
Oh, that's very interesting. You do so much, Lindsay. But since this is a commercial real estate podcast, can you describe how you help fund managers raise capital for different types of asset classes and specifically in the commercial real estate space?
Sure. So private fund structuring largely relates to where can we sell it and what kind of tax impact is it going to have depending on who you've sold to. So look a lot at, do we use for commercial real estate something like a REIT to deal with certain tax blocking aspects? In the corporate credit space, we're looking at what type of structure can we design to deal with effectively connected income. So there's a lot of things around how the structure gets built. It's also choosing the correct domicile, which will be things that, you know, specific types of investors, for instance, may want to have a European domiciled structure that they face off against, whereas others may prefer to have a Delaware domiciled structure. So that's kind of really where we get into it. And then there are other things where we're considering, you know, insurance capital. So we're looking for risk-based capital efficient solutions. There are some things about that with real estate debt that we can get into, but mainly I'm just looking to design structures that are going to bring together the capital that investors are looking to deploy and managers who have great designs on what they want to do with that capital to bring it to the market.
So pausing on that point, you said that you help debt funds and other fund managers get access to insurance company capital. Could you describe in a little bit of detail how a real estate related fund could take advantage of these sorts of structures?
Sure. So in the context of capital efficient investing, you need to have a rating on the note component that's issued out of the fund itself. So as a very high level background, investment into private funds by an insurance company is treated with a 30% capital charge if it's just an equity investment into a private fund. That gives you a very sort of skewed look through type of position. So they're treated as holding only equity when the fund itself may hold debt that would get a much better capital efficient charge. So you try to structure the way in which they come into the investment so that they are holding at least partially or maybe solely rated debt. Commercial real estate and related products, so commercial real estate debt, can be difficult to get a rating on because unlike corporate credit, which you can, you know, kind of have a set parameter and virtually every deal that you do could fit within that set parameter, real estate, of course, is related to the specific property that it's tied to. So that can cause issues with being able to get a rating on a blind pool. So in this context, we've kind of had a couple of different scenarios. One is to warehouse assets so that when you go to get a rating, you would have a big enough pool that is actually identified that the rating agency could take a look at. That can vary depending on the rating agency, right? Sometimes it might need to be the entire pool. Other things are typically these are rated under a specific funds methodology. We've had a real estate debt fund that is actually more suited to the CMBS methodology at some rating agencies. So that might be something that can work. The other option is to go with Egan-Jones as a rating agency, which they are able to rate on a blind pool basis for commercial real estate. That may or may not be something that the investors are ultimately happy with as a long-term rating. So in that context, if you wanted to, you could wait until there was, you know, a critical mass or even full deployment of the assets in the fund and then have a different rating agency do that. But again, who the rating agency is and investor levels of comfort with that is very specific to the investor group. So you would need to talk to them about that. But we have successfully rated several CRE related funds for insurance investing.
So that's super interesting. So just to make sure that I've got my brain around what you were describing, one could be an existing fund with a host of CRE assets that they're either maintaining on their balance sheet or they have on other warehouses or in CRE CLOs or other sort of vehicles where they're kind of exposed to the cash flow and the residuals, and they could get a rating on their fund structure and then get access to insurance company capital at a more efficient rate than if the insurance company were just an investor in the fund?
Yes. So the insurance company is getting a better risk-based capital treatment by holding notes rather than just holding a direct equity interest. If they hold a vertical strip, they will have a residual equity charge, which is 45%. So that's an increase on the equity if they just came into the fund. However, when you blend the note rates plus the slightly higher residual rate, you'll still get a substantial reduction in the risk-based capital charge.
And Lindsay, it's Sam. I'm one of the real estate meatheads that John was mentioning earlier. When you mentioned CRE and commercial real estate, right, I automatically just think office buildings and hotels and industrial properties. But is this technology something that could finance other kind of real estate adjacent products, right? We've been talking a lot about CPACE recently and CPACE assessments. Would that type of product fit into this as well?
CPACE is pretty new for me, at least. So we've definitely been working together on, you know, different types of structures that can work for CPACE. I mean, ultimately, CPACE is just another type of asset class, right? So funds are asset gathering vehicles. We bring investors to managers. So from my perspective, it's any other fundraise. I think that the more interesting thing would be, is there an ability to get something like this rated? CPACE assets don't necessarily traditionally follow the methods that we would want in relation to getting a rating with regard to some types of distributions because of the way that the liens are put together. So it's something we haven't really gotten into yet, but I'm looking forward to seeing if that would be an option. Regardless, however, whether it's insurance money or not, you can certainly do fund structures that are great for something like CPACE. I find it really interesting as a structuring specialist that, you know, CPACE assets don't actually follow the traditional real estate related tax issues, and they're actually more like corporate lending tax matters. So when we've structured, it's actually bringing more of my credit expertise in like corporate credit than real estate credit. So that's been quite interesting, but there's certainly a lot of options to bring in new asset classes like CPACE.
Is some of this going to depend on if rating agencies have fully fleshed out methodologies that they're able to deploy that we can use?
To an extent, really, rating is quite a straightforward thing when you think about it, right? They're taking a look at the assets, the maturity of the bonds, and deciding, is there enough to support both the full repayment of principal, but also the consistent payment of interest during that time frame? So you're usually looking at assets that have income production on a regular basis and are relatively stable. Under the funds methodology, they're also looking at that on a blind pool basis. So, you know, funds traditionally just sort of show up. We don't have a warehouse, right? We've just got a bunch of cash, got to go deploy it. So when they're looking into that kind of aspect of the rating, they're looking a lot at the manager's track record and history in that specific asset class. So it can be more difficult in the context of ratings if you've got newer asset classes, and not just newer asset classes, but even newer asset classes to that specific manager. So you could have a manager that's got, you know, 30 years experience in doing something, and then they decide to kind of open a new strategy, and that still may not be sufficient in the context of a blind pool rating. Whether or not something like CPACE can fit into that would also depend on whether or not the rating agency is comfortable with the assets. Like, they have specialists within different asset classes within their relevant companies. So you kind of need to discuss with different rating agencies, have they seen it? Do they know how it works? Are they able to actually rate the assets themselves? Like, do they think they could rate those as individual assets? You know, those types of things would become part of that discussion. So it is, I guess, something that as you get going into a process with a new asset class, it can end up taking quite a bit longer to get through a rating process than it would with something more straightforward like corporate credit.
Lindsay, is the rated fund requirement really only something that insurance companies care about, or do other investors also want a rated fund?
Generally, it's something that's mainly aimed towards insurance investors because of their regulatory capital positions. There are other types of regulated entities such as transfer agents and to some extent banks to where rated debt could be the solution for them. It may not necessarily be in the same type of structure that we do for insurance company rated funds, but there's certainly a lot of folks out there in the market who are looking for rated debt. Also within that, you're looking at other types of entities who maybe are seeking to have more exposure to debt. In that case, they may not take the equity portion. They'd just be looking to do it as a lender. And so the rating could help them ultimately in their overall goals with having credit exposure.
So a structure that we've used in SFR and in commercial real estate in order to get a rated structure is to take a specific pool of assets and securitize it, and then have a rating agency rate that securitization. So sometimes we'll do this in a kind of regular way, single investor securitization. Sometimes we'll do like a direct issuance where instead of a loan collateralizing the deal, we have the collateral itself and like no loan, and through various structuring elements, no asset-backed securities, so no risk retention and no 15G filing and all of that. How does that compare to the kind of fund structures you deploy? And is there an advantage or disadvantage to using a fund structure over a kind of captive securitization?
So comparatively, rated funds are traditionally quite a bit different. It depends a little bit on if you're selling the debt and the equity separately. If you're selling them separately, you might end up with some sort of security involved, but it's generally going to be quite a bit less than you would tend to see in the context of like a true securitization. The other thing is the methodology is quite a bit different. Traditional securitization methodologies have quite stringent guidelines on buckets for different types of assets. The funds methodology is generally quite a bit more wide open. You're looking at what your future portfolio is likely to look like. It's going to be re-rated every year to sort of make sure that the manager is on track to keep up with that. So they can look quite a bit different. Also, the features are much more fund-like. So in a vertical strip deal, you'll likely have revolving notes so that the traditional commitment and drawdown structure of closed-end funds can be held true. You'll also have an equity tranche that is real equity traditionally instead of subordinated notes. And that just helps tie the fund elements in, which are much more traditionally limited partnership interests, right, for funds. The other kind of key difference is that not all, we certainly do a lot of standalone rated funds, but a vast proportion of rated funds are actually done as feeder funds into a master fund. So that basically means that the only asset that's held by that feeder is an LP interest in the master fund, which means that you've got a lot of different things because you have debt collateralized by equity. And so you've got a lot of things you kind of have to keep together. And then you also have to hold true to the master fund's terms and make sure that the rated feeder isn't going to in some way jeopardize the success of the master fund or its relationship with its other limited partners who may not be coming in through any type of structured product.
So you said that the funds themselves have to be re-rated. How do you fall short on getting your rating renewed? And what's the consequence if you have the rating downgraded?
Thus far, thank goodness, none of them that I know of, certainly none of ours, have ever been downgraded. It's really just a check, right? If we're doing a rating based on an entirely blind pool, what they're looking at is to make sure that the types of assets that were expected to be purchased or originated are actually what's ending up in the structure. I think ultimately, if you were to get downgraded, of course, that will adjust your NAIC designation in relation to the relevant notes. So if you had investment grade and you get downgraded to below investment grade, that's going to drop you notches in the NAIC designation, which means a less capital efficient treatment. So there's, you know, some definite impacts if you don't do that. But as I said, generally, because the requirements for the rating is that you have a manager that has a very good track record in that specific asset class, you're expecting that the pool is going to come together as it was sort of envisaged and going to operate in that same way.
So Lindsay, just for our moms who may be listening in on the podcast and aren't that familiar with financial structures and the acronyms we tend to use, could you tell us what the NAIC is?
Sure. So it's the National Association of Insurance Commissioners. Within the United States, each state is actually responsible for regulating the insurance companies that are domiciled within their borders. So instead of having a federal level regulator for insurance companies, essentially each state regulator has sort of gotten together and they created this association of all of the different insurance commissioners within the 50 states. It's, I would say, more of a self-regulatory body, although technically it isn't a regulatory body. Essentially, what they do is they have groups that get together and they come up with consistent practice so that the states all sort of follow very similar provisions in the context of things, for instance, like a risk-based capital charge. So that way there is a hope that there isn't any kind of state-by-state arbitrage or insurance companies in one state are doing things that could put jeopardy to insured persons throughout the United States. Because although they may be domiciled in one particular state, most insurance companies sell across state borders. So it's essentially a group that gets together several times a year. They have an unbelievable amount of different committees that cover every single aspect of insurance and insurance risk. So they're a very interesting body, a lot of very smart and wonderful people to get to know in there. And they really do have the best interests, I think, of both the insurance industry and the insured people out there that are subject to these rules at heart in everything that they do. So some of the things that they apply to structures like rated funds are concerned with: what are the real risks to the insurance companies? We're trying to make sure that insurance companies have sufficient capital to pay out insurance policies in the event of particularly a disaster of some sort or a huge insurance event. So it's really just a group of folks that are trying to get together and make sure that there's consistency state to state.
It sounds like you have a much better relationship with your regulator than other asset classes have with their regulator.
Lindsay, is there one state that controls or takes the lead on things? I mean, I know in LLC land, right, Delaware is sort of the state that everyone looks to. When I think of insurance, I think of Hartford, Connecticut. But I don't know if there's one state out there or a couple states where most of these insurance companies are domiciled.
There's a lot in every state. I think generally it's viewed, although I am by no means an insurance regulation specialist, but generally it's viewed that Iowa is one of the leading states. So I tend to see the Iowa regulator at the helm or quite active in most of the committees that touch this asset class.
I wonder if they have very good lobbying in California, because under the climate disclosure rules, which we were talking about before, I noticed that one of the carve-outs to the SB 261 rule was that it doesn't actually apply to insurance companies. So I thought that was just interesting. So Lindsay, in our world, we joke a lot about all the acronyms we use. And I thank you again for talking about the NAIC. We often talk on this podcast about CRE CLOs, which are commercial real estate collateralized loan obligations. But you recently co-authored an article on CFOs, or collateralized fund obligations. Could you describe for us what are CFOs and how do they differ from UFOs?
Well, they certainly might be the little green men of the securitization world, I guess. So collateralized fund obligations are more or less what they say on the tin. It's basically a securitization of fund interests. So some people might be familiar with the concept of a fund of funds, so a fund that invests in other funds to fulfill its investment strategy. A CFO is essentially taking that to a slightly higher level. You basically will have generally, although not always, quite a diverse pool of underlying fund interests. They are generally purchased on a secondary basis or transferred in. So if it's an LP-led CFO, you might have somebody who has a substantial amount of closed-end private fund interests on their books. So private equity funds, private credit, private real estate, all of those types of different funds. And at a certain point, for them, it may be more beneficial to refinance that book so that they could get additional capital to put into new funds, right? Closed-end funds have a finite life, so they are going to have generally pretty consistent distributions after their investment period. So it fits well to have a pool that's kind of mixed of some that might still be in their investment period, some that might be in their harvest period. But essentially, you package all those together into a securitization and you issue debt to refinance that portfolio. For general partners, it might be slightly different. If they're leading, right, they're looking for getting capital into a pool of funds. So they might be transferring in perhaps their own GP interests or other types of interests that they have, or maybe having the securitization purchase new interests in existing funds. So it's quite a diverse sort of underlying method of getting funds into it. But ultimately, it's a similar type of structure, right? Very appealing for insurance companies to take the debt tranches. Placing the equity is similar to most CLOs, something a little bit more difficult to do, but providing, you know, a first loss piece, so highly levered returns on a pool of underlying LP interest. So they're quite a cool structure. They've come back quite a bit in the past couple of years. And so we've done quite a number of these, and we're continuing to see a lot of interest from different areas, particularly folks like pension plans, perhaps, that have a huge book of LP interest that they would like to refinance so that they have additional capital to invest.
Well, this has been great, Lindsay. A great conversation and some really interesting stuff out there in the fundverse, and certainly more complicated and involved than what us real estate meatheads do on a daily basis. Thank you, John. But just a final question. I mean, what do you think is next out there in the world of fund formation?
I think it's one of the things I love the most about fund formation is that you never know what's coming next, right? You can have any kind of asset class in the fund. Fund structures are evolving. They have newer things that maybe we didn't have before. So for instance, the rated fund structure. We definitely see a substantial amount of interest in captive equity for structured product platforms. So traditional CLOs, CRE CLOs, the ability basically to gather assets so that you have a consistent pool to take that equity tranche in a securitization. The other thing that I'm seeing a lot of is the rise of what we call evergreen funds. So traditionally in the private fund space, there's been a lot of closed-end funds for illiquid asset classes, right? So leaving aside the hedge funds. But we're definitely seeing a lot more hybrid technology brought over from hedge funds into the liquid asset classes so that you can have a fund that doesn't have a finite life. We might put something like a finite life rated feeder onto that structure, but the pool can consistently reinvest, and then investors can have certain levels of liquidity to come in and out from that, which can help both the manager in having a consistent pool to deploy, but also for certain types of investors that, you know, it's a problem for them, or they don't like to have to go back to their investment committee every couple of years when the next vintage of a closed-end fund comes up. You know, they may be able to just say, well, we've already done the diligence on this fund, we're just adding capital to it. So we're definitely seeing quite a bit more of that than we have in the past. And it's a great evolution, I think, in the context of funds.
Lindsay, thanks so much for coming and joining us on the Dechert 4Rail podcast. It's been great hearing about this stuff from you.
Thank you so much, you guys. This has been great. And I love getting to work with my real estate colleagues. And hopefully we can continue to develop even more cool structures for everybody.
Yeah, if you can tolerate all of our caveman meathead questions. If you want to read Lindsay's article, by the way, on collateralized fund obligations, we'll have a link to it in the show notes. I think that brings us to our 4Rail high fives. Does anybody have anyone they want to thank this month?
I'd really like to thank Jason Roses, who is a former guest of our podcast and is a partner here in Dechert's global finance practice. Jason really helped us get up to speed on the SEC climate disclosure rules. Thanks, Jason. Lindsay, do you want to give anyone a high five? Because you're welcome to as well.
No, but I did want to do a tiny shameless plug if I can.
Yeah, please.
Okay. I also just wanted to let people know I sit within the structured products group and we have started a vlog series. So that will be available in our newest credit publication, The Cred. And there will be a link to our first episode where I interview the head of ratings for KDRA. So we can talk a little bit more about rated funds.
That's amazing. Did you say vlog or blog?
Vlog. Yes. Videos, of course. It's on the Dechert YouTube channel. Yes.
Just one more way that Lindsay's group is a little more high tech than ours.
Yes, but you can't listen to a vlog on the train, you know, I guess is the only issue.
Oh, sure. You just play the YouTube video with your phone screen active and then put it in your pocket on your headphones. That's what I always do.
See, you're much better at this commuting thing than me, John.
I like my walks in the spring to work to check out the cherry blossoms. If you have any thoughts, please share them with us at our email inbox. It is realpodcast@dechert.com. Also, if you like what you heard, give us a 5-star rating on whatever platform that you found this on. This episode was hosted by Sam Gilbert, Ella Smith, and me, John Gaynor. It was produced by Stuart McQueen, Matt Armstrong, and Kate Mylod. Production support is by Kara Ray, Mallory Gorm, Alyssa Norton, Peggy Hefner, Lisa Caramelango, and Jacob Kimmel. Our editor is Andy Robbins of Audiophile Solutions. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time on the Dechert 4Rail podcast.
So, John, have you heard any good dad jokes lately?
No, but our last guest, Ken Hackman, gave me one right after we recorded.
Let's hear it, John.
All right. How do you tell the difference between an alligator and a crocodile?
How?
You'll see one later and the other after a while.
That's good. We'll see you later, alligator.
After a while, crocodile.
Glad we didn't subject Lindsay to that.